What are the current limitations of LLMs in financial contexts, and how might future advancements in areas like causal reasoning and knowledge representation unlock new possibilities? Well, that's a really interesting question. There are a number of limitations that I think many people know about. LLMs are not that good at numbers, per se. They're very good with language, but for whatever reason, when you start asking numerical questions, they easily get tripped up. A friend of mine recently just gave me an example. Try asking an LLM to name all of the capitals of European countries and rank them by population. That seems like a pretty straightforward question, but you'd be surprised how difficult it is for typical LLMs to get that correct. And there are all sorts of conjectures as to why that might be the case, but we don't really know. And so at this point, we need to start coming up with better ways of informing LLMs with respect to these kinds of numerical questions and to be able to integrate them into their text-based abilities. That's a key aspect of financial context, because everything that we do in finance is both numbers and language. In terms of causal reasoning, now this is getting on the border of the theoretical and beyond it, the science fiction. The question that I sometimes get asked by my students is, do LLMs really understand? And, you know, I have to answer the question with the question, which is, well, what do you mean by understand? And that's a very difficult concept to deconstruct, because we ourselves don't understand what we mean by understand. But let me give you an idea of how I'm beginning to understand understanding. The way that you test whether somebody really understands something is very much like how we test our PhD candidates when we give them the oral exam. And I'll tell you how I give my oral exam. I'll start with an easy question. And if the student that's taking the exam answers it correctly, I'll move on and I'll give them a harder version. And if they answer that correctly, I'll give them yet another version that's even harder. And I will keep increasing the level of difficulty and changing the context of the question to really probe the limits of that student's knowledge. Because what I want to understand is how much they understand. How deep is their understanding? So at some point, I'll get to the point where a student will get it wrong. And that tells me that they don't really understand the particular question that I'm asking. And I'll ask them one more question after that that is deeper still, just to see whether or not it was just a careless mistake or whether or not it's really true that now we're in deeper waters that they really haven't ever tread. And if they continue to falter, I will have determined that that's their level of understanding. So let's apply that approach to a large language model. We ask it a question, it provides an answer, and the answer seems correct. We'll provide a harder version, and that seems correct. At some point, we will reach a level where the LLM will not be able to answer correctly. And so you can think of it as going down below the level of knowledge to the point where there's no more answers to be gotten. That kind of depth of knowledge is a form of understanding. Right now, I would say that LLMs are quite shallow. They can answer in complete sentences. Most of those sentences make sense. And if you ask them questions, they can usually provide reasonably correct answers. If you ask them to write a piece of code that engages in certain calculations, they can usually do that correctly, perhaps with some modification. But that tells me that their level of understanding is very shallow. The next generation of LLMs ought to be able to answer questions at 2, 3, 4 levels of depth. And there will come a point in time where they will exceed our capacity to answer those questions. And at that point, I believe we will then say they understand. And then causal reasoning will be possible. So it's coming. But in the world of LLMs, it's going to take a while before they get to the point where we consider it to be truly causal understanding. We've got a question from one of our social media followers. Applications of machine learning to forecasting clinical trial outcomes and improving investment performance in the biopharma industry. Well, thank you for that. That's referring to some research that I've done over the last few years with a number of my collaborators, applying machine learning techniques to predicting the outcome of clinical trials. I got interested in that because a number of friends and family were dealing with various kinds of cancer a few years ago. And I realized that actually money plays a huge role in drug development. It turns out that money can be scarce, particularly at the very earliest stages of drug discovery, because that's when the risk is the highest. And so the so-called valley of death between early stage research and the first in human clinical trials, that's the area that I started thinking about. How do we get more money to come into that space to help get over this valley of death? And the answer, of course, is you need investors. But how do you attract investors? The way you attract them is by demonstrating that there are some attractive opportunities to make money with their capital. And in order to do that, you need to have some kind of statistical framework for thinking about risk and reward. Over the last few years, my collaborators and I have applied machine learning techniques, and now we're using large language models to try to read all of the body of information about medical clinical trials and what kinds of features tend to make them more successful and other features that make them less successful, and use those features to predict outcomes so that we can tell investors under what circumstances are you likely to do better or worse. We can actually provide them with a framework for thinking about how to manage risk. And if we do that, we assume that they will then be more willing to deploy their capital as they have in other industries where these tools have been made available. So stay tuned, and hopefully we'll be able to tell you more about that over the course of the next few years as we apply these models in practical circumstances. Okay, another social media post. What's the dark side of AI and what's the bright side, and which is more likely to occur? Well, that's the age-old question of good versus evil, and I'm happy to talk about both. I think I already mentioned a bit about the dark side of AI. Powerful tools can be used for adverse purposes. Things like cheating on your tax returns, coming up with fake news that will fool a certain part of the population for financial or political gain. Those are the kinds of things that not only can AI be used for, but I suspect that has already been used for. And so I think that we really need to consider ways of guarding against that. We need antidotes for fake news and for manipulation that really is not what we intend with these amazing tools. On the positive side, I think there is tremendous potential for AI to transform society. I'll give you one very, very simple example that's already being done. If you take patient medical records and look at the various different kinds of behaviors that people engage in and the diseases that they suffer from, we now are able to come up with all sorts of hypotheses for certain kinds of things that we can do to improve our health. Now, you already know some of those things, like exercise, have a proper balanced diet, sleep well, so on and so forth. But there are lots of nuances to those broad-based pieces of advice that have to be tailored just to you. And so this is where LLMs can really shine. They can take your medical records, they take the sum total of all of the knowledge that's in the medical system, and ultimately tailor that advice to be suited to your particular health goals. Now, we're not there yet because obviously the hallucination problem can be very, very dangerous in the medical context, but I don't think we're that far away, particularly given the rapid pace at which we're making progress. Okay, another social media post. How can non-engineers get involved in AI? That's a wonderful question. One of the reasons that I was so excited by the advent of broad-based large language models, and you've already played with many of them, I'm sure, large language models have democratized AI so that you don't have to be an engineer to make use of AI. That wasn't true a couple of years ago. If you wanted to use machine learning, you needed to have programming experience. There were very few generic, non-technical machine learning engines, if any, that would allow people who didn't understand the intricacies of these various different random forest models and so on to be able to use them in any way that would be beneficial. With large language models, we can actually speak in plain English. And moreover, there are a number of non-engineers that I've met who have become extraordinarily good at formulating just the right prompt in order to be able to get the desired outcome from these different LLMs. So I think the answer is absolutely non-engineers can become extremely adept at AI, and the way to do it is to use it. Start playing with your favorite LLM and just talk to it, ask it a bunch of questions. In a way, that's kind of how we develop relationships right now with our human friends. We begin by asking them questions and gauging their answers, and based upon what we hear, we either decide to become better friends with them or decide stay away, we're not interested. With LLMs, we need to talk with them in order to understand how they operate, understand where they're coming from, understand what they can do for us. And once we develop that kind of, dare I say, rapport, we will then be adept at being able to prompt them in the most efficient manner. You do not have to have an engineering degree to be able to do that. Anybody watching this video can do this. And I would urge you all to try doing it as soon as you can. Another social media post: are cryptocurrencies a temporary phenomenon or are they here to stay? Yes, they are here to stay. But no, the cryptocurrency that you're trading may not be here forever. The idea of cryptocurrency is extremely powerful, and it provides enormous benefits for financial transactions of a variety of different sorts. At the same time, it also has a number of flaws that can be exploited by bad actors and the improper usage of crypto. A lot's going to change over the course of the next few years. In fact, one of the biggest changes that I think we should all watch out for is when a very large and stable sovereign entity decides to issue crypto of its own. For example, imagine the United States decides to issue Fedcoin, and that becomes the cryptocurrency of preference for the entire world. If that happens, then the existing cryptocurrencies may not do as well. Without a doubt, some of them will become worthless overnight. And if that's your currency that you're holding your wealth in, that's not good news for you. In a way, this happened in the 1800s, because as the West was being developed in the US, a number of banks arose to finance that kind of development. And these banks would print their own currency to be able to hand out to workers that wanted to get paid. And of course, these are like bonds that the banks were issuing. The problem is that every once in a while, these pieces of paper would become worthless because the bank would go out of business. They would extend too far and they couldn't basically make good on all of these pieces of paper. Now, these pieces of paper often had pictures of wildcats on them because that's the animal that dominated the population in the West as it was being developed. And so this phenomenon called wildcat banking became quite prominent in the mid-1800s. And at some point, the number of failures became so bad that the US government stepped in and basically shut down this whole wildcat banking system by creating the Federal Reserve and providing a much broader base of laws and the US currency that supplanted all of these wildcat currencies. So pretty much overnight, as the US began to issue its own currency, that made these particular smaller currencies worthless. If a sovereign entity were to issue a cryptocurrency and that ended up taking the place of a number of existing currencies, you need to worry about whether or not your currency is the one that's going to become worthless. So that's one of the challenges of investing in crypto. But without a doubt, the technology that is used in crypto is here to stay. And I believe that cryptocurrencies themselves as an asset class are here to stay, but you need to think about how to manage that risk very carefully. Can't believe it, but this is the last question from our social media friends. How can we deal with large-scale market manipulation now that LLMs are so cheap to deploy at large scale? Wow, what a question to end on. So it turns out that one of the things that large language models could be very capable of is providing fraudsters and other bad actors with the appropriate technology for disrupting financial stability. Now, this may seem far-fetched, but I bet you if you asked the large language model how to build an atomic bomb, you'd probably get a pretty reasonable answer. And so it actually scares me that now the knowledge of the entire financial literature is available to bad actors who can use large language models to summarize the ways that they can involve their various different nefarious plots within the financial system. The regulators also have access to large language models, and I believe that they are also using the tools of AI to figure out how to detect these kinds of schemes while they're being hatched and before they occur. But as I said earlier, it is an arms race. And this is one of the reasons why we at CSAIL are making these videos. We want all of you to start thinking about how to use these tools to make society a better place. There's no doubt that there's tremendous value in these new technologies, but there's also some potential dangers that we have to worry about. And the only way that we're going to get better at it is if more and better people are involved. Well, that's it for the questions. Can't believe that we're all done. But thank you so much for taking the time to submit them. It was fascinating, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Bye-bye.